After an impressive rally in February, the Philippine Stock Exchange slightly pulled back in March. This, as investors digested a string of corporate earnings, while an uptick in inflation pointed to interest rates staying higher for longer. What should we expect this April? For our monthly market outlook, we're joined by COL Financial Group's Zurge Zendueta and founder of the Millennial Trader, Harold Tan. You know, the PSEI was flirting with the 7,000 level, and it has retreated now to the 6,800 level. So I guess the question in everybody's mind is, are we just seeing a correction right now, or do you think there is a possibility that we would see a repeat of 2023, where the market was initially very strong, but, you know, when the year ended, it was virtually flat or, you know, even down slightly. Let me begin with you, Zurge.
I think the likelihood of another 2023 event happening this time around could be less, sans a hard landing scenario in the U.S. Although I think the consolidation that we're seeing right now is warranted also, given how fast the market has moved technically since the beginning of December up until, let's say, middle of Feb. So it's just digesting the gains, in my opinion. I think the 7,000 to 7,100 area was a natural stopping point for the market, given that, number one, it's a technical resistance area. And then I think number two, you could rationalize it. It's fair value, at least in terms of how the fundamentals are shaking out based on where interest rates are at the moment. It makes a lot of sense for it to just really stop there. It's possible that the correction this time around could deepen a little bit. So the key support area I'm looking at is maybe around 6.7 to 6.8. So 6.8 initially, that's the low end of the range where the market is at. Then if it breaks 6.7, maybe it could go to 6.5. Anything lower than that, I think has a lower probability right now, unless we do see a hard landing scenario in the US. So I think eventually at the end of the year, there's a good chance we break out of 7.1, then maybe go to 7.5. So that's where I see things.
Yeah, I guess, you know, a lot of analysts have that 7,100 as the target. So I guess if fundamentals are actually better than expected, then maybe we could break out of that and, you know, reach, as you said, as much as 7.5. Okay, so what about you, Harold? What are your thoughts on this? I mean, are we just going to see a correction, or, you know, it's like the end of, you know, the rally for the year?
Yeah, actually, April, I agree with Serge. No, what happened last year during the March again, we hit 7,000 level, is a different scenario, which was we have a very high inflation, which reached up around like 8%. We have the surprise inflation numbers. So right now, I could not consider that of happening again. So the risk is very minimal. And we are in a phase that the Fed is pausing rates. So the likelihood that they will be hawkish again is very minimal, since we are nearing the US election on November. So once we started to cut rates, maybe that's the time that we will be experiencing a robust market. So maybe the correction or the pause would still be an advantageous for us, so long we hold the 6,700 or even 6,800 level. And then for me, there would be a higher possibility, and inevitably we will break 7,000 on the upside by April or by May.
So 6,700 and 6,800, you know, is the support level for you, same as Zurge. If 6,768 breaks, what is the next support level for you?
For me, I would give also 6.5 level, since it is a very strong support. So if we break 6,800, I think we would be experiencing a longer consolidation until break 7,000 if we did not manage to hold 6,800 for me.
Is inflation and interest rates, or are both of them still top of mind as far as investors are concerned, you know, potentially derailing a a stronger than expected performance of the stock market because you had mentioned rising commodity prices.
So yeah, for me, it is still the factor up to this point, but I don't believe it will be sus it will be a sustainable rally even for the cocoa since I have seen some divergences. So maybe on the short-term perspective, that's why. But of course, we know the how the market will react or the investors will react on negative news. If they would see some negativity, investors will react immediately upon that news. And then of course we could see worse is a correction. And with that I believe that would not be a very long-term correction for me.
So, Zerge, I'd like to ask you, what are some of the risks that could derail a bull run this year? Of course, we have high inflation, high interest rates, but aside from that, what other risks are you looking at?
I think this has been mentioned also in the past, but it's hard to really quantify. But I think a policy error in terms of the Fed is something that the risk that the market should anticipate. The main caveat behind that, of course, is we don't know exactly what an error is, whether if it's cutting too late, the bar cutting too early. Hindi naman talaga natin siya alam, and it's something that you only know after the fact. I guess what we know right now is that the Fed is more biased to cut after the recent FOMC. And they, I mean, at least it looks like they're still looking at 3 rate cuts for the year. And that's despite like the last 2 US inflation prints coming in hotter than expected. So I think what that tells you is the Fed wants to cut. They want to protect maybe this nascent recovery that you're seeing in the US. But at the same time, if you really think about it, do they really need to cut if the economy is as strong as they say, as it looks? So, and inflation is actually like I think Harold just mentioned there, no? I think a lot of the agricultural commodities recently have been picking up. Although I think a lot of the move is because of the weather. Nevertheless, we're seeing it spike. So yeah, I think the Fed mistake is number one, whether they cut too early or too late. But yeah, the risk there is we'll only know after the fact. And then the next one, which really pertains more to the Philippines, I think we really touched on it. It's the food inflation. We already saw a surprise acceleration out of the inflation print last month, so came in 3.4. Expectation was just 3. And I think what's interesting about the inflation dynamic is that the Philippine inflation basket, 35% of it is food, and then about 9% of the whole is rice. Rice alone. And rice is already up more than 20% year in year in terms of price. So the issue with rice and the fact that at least there's still a high incidence of poverty in the Philippines is pag mataas yung presyo ng kanin, the Filipino people is not able to spend on other things. Of course, they'll prioritize food. So that's something that could crimp consumption. And then definitely if input costs are high, commodity prices are high, that's also going to eat up on the margins of some of the corporates. So for me, I think those are the two major concerns that could derail the rally. The first one, the Fed mistake, that's something that could derail the global rally. The second one, that's something that could probably cap the move of the Philippines because it's more particular to us. But like I say, we're the largest rice importer already in the world by quite a margin. So that was a bit of a surprise also for me.
And also, I think you mentioned that your bullish scenario is based on the possibility that there will be no hard landing in the US, but do you think that it is still a possibility?
I think it might still be it. For me, to be honest with you, with you, I think it's a very confusing time in the market. There are many mixed indicators that are really there. Like I say, if you look at the Conference Board Leading Economic Indicators Index, it's showing you that a recession should happen. But where's the recession, right? You look at retail sales, it's strong. You look at the GDP
Yeah,
nowcast of the
the
US,
unemployment numbers
the
are,
unemployment
pretty
numbers.
strong. Yeah, the job numbers. So.
So I think, I mean, you could always say this time around could be different. Like I say, interest rates are high. You would think it would already affect the US consumer, but there's also this buy now, pay later sort of trend has also picked up in the US, diba? So pwedeng labanan pa ng consumer, pwede pa sila gumastos because they have that. So you have those things going on in the background. And then of course, the past 10 to 15 years have been unprecedented in a sense that you had zero interest rates. So a lot of people were able to lock in, like I say, their mortgages at maybe 0 to 2%. So there's no impending challenge yet in terms of high rates. But eventually, it's gonna catch up to you. So for me, at the back of my mind, I can't rule out the possibility of a hard landing. It's not my base case. To be honest, I actually think the US scenario will be a benign scenario for this year. I think that's the word that I was really looking for. Benign, meaning, I mean, it's just back to normal programming, like let's say pre-GFC. But I can't completely rule out that a hard landing is still possible, just given how historical precedents have panned out. Like I say, even the length of time that a recession could happen after the yield curve inverts, meron eh, and then the quality of the jobs also being added, it's not that strong. You need to keep it at the back of your mind.
We're taking a short break. When we come back, what stocks should we put our focus on at this time?
I would give Converge a chance. This Converge, I could put it in the light of strong business but lousy stock.
And then the last one, I really like FGen also. So FGen trading around 5 times PE. It's a clean energy play. The dividend yield's probably somewhere around 5% also. So not a lot of people are I guess are watching it at the moment.